Nestled within the Staffordshire countryside, Alton Towers has long been heralded as a premier destination for thrill seekers and amusement enthusiasts. Over the years, this iconic theme park has undergone numerous transformations, evolving with the times and leaving behind a trail of memories. Join us on a nostalgic journey as we delve into the archives to rediscover the magic, excitement and innovation that have shaped the history of Alton Towers. One of the shortest-lived flat rides at the resort, the Magic Carpet opened at the beginning of the 1984 season, having been installed in Festival Park. In line with most additions at the time, it was in fact a travelling ride. However, it did feature some light Arabian theming. A simple lap bar secured guests into seats on a Magic Carpet themed gondola. The carpet was suspended from four arms and would swing before completing a full rotation. It offered a fun rising and falling sensation, as well as negative G's as it went over the top. Introduced later the same year was 1001 Nights, which offered a similar theme but a taller and more thrilling experience. The Magic Carpet was lightly overshadowed by its larger companion, and Alton Towers removed the Magic Carpet at the end of the 1985 season. The decision is almost certainly due to the reduced popularity and comparisons with 1001 Nights. Following its removal from Alton Towers, the Magic Carpet continued to travel the fairground circuit, finding a more permanent home at M&D's amusement park before it retired in 2016. Opening in the summer of 1979 and being located in the Springfield Centre area of the park, the Alpine Bobsleigh predated Alton Towers' transformation into a theme park. The attraction was opened by the British Olympic bobsleigh team and featured a pair of side-by-side asbestos channels. Using the natural slope of Springfield Centre, the tracks would wind downhill for 160 metres. Starting with a launch station where Just Chicken is located today, riders would sit in very small plastic sleds with a manual brake. It was an entirely gravity-powered ride, and sleds could reach speeds of 40 kilometres per hour if the brake was used sparingly. The ride ended close to the area now occupied by Oblivion's Brake Run. Although a fun attraction and popular with visitors, the Alpine bobsleigh had a terribly low capacity and could not be operated in rain due to the sleds running too fast. A rider-operated attraction of this type also caused the park concerns as it became more safety conscious. Eventually, the ride's fate was sealed when a ban on the installation of asbestos came into effect, and the ride was removed at the end of 1986. It seems the channels were not fully removed, as years later photographs showing sections of the ride overgrown in the woods emerged online. The first of three roller coasters to be installed on Coach Park 3 behind Talbot Street, the Four-Man Bob arrived at the park in 1985. This modest Zero coaster was added to help with the crowds attracted by the runaway success of the Corkscrew and Black Hole. The ride had originally operated at nearby Trentham Gardens the prior year before moving to Alton Towers. Four-Man Bob was a travelling coaster featuring green supports and red track and only reaching a height of 21 feet. Four people could sit in line in bobsleigh-style cars to race along the twisting layout full of swooping turns. At the end, an operator would use a manual brake to slow and stop the cars. In 1988, the Four-Man Bob was joined by the Alton Mouse and the Alton Beast, creating an area commonly known as Coaster Corner. The creation of Coaster Corner was also part of its downfall. The new rides were larger, noisier, and could be seen from outside the park. Local residents were not happy with their new neighbours, and the Four-Man Bob was the first to be removed. It was also likely that the travelling model with manual controls didn't fit the new vision the owner's Two Swords had for Alton Towers. 1990 was its last season at the park, and it was briefly replaced by the TriStar before the area was closed altogether. The Four-Man Bob found many new homes over the years, spending time at Pleasure Island and Flamingoland, before getting a refurbishment and being installed at Groveland. The refurbishment removed the bobsleigh trains, and minecart trains were added instead. After some time at Loudoun Castle, the ride eventually found its way to France, and operates to this day as Gold Rush at Family Park. For 1981, boosted by the success of the Corkscrew, Alton Towers added a new themed area. Talbot Street was located behind the towers and was a themed Victorian street full of shops, restaurants and attractions. The Around the World in 80 Days ride was also added, and a small area of its building was used to house a haunted attraction. Doom and Sons invited guests to explore a spooky Victorian funeral parlour. The attraction itself was accessed through a plaza close to the entrance of Around the World in 80 Days. It was aimed at more older guests than its neighbour, and visitors would be welcomed by Mr. Doom himself. The attraction was quite small and was a walkthrough of the funeral parlour's various rooms. Theming was provided by Keith Sparks and Associates, with guests exploring a music room, haunted library and a chapel of rest. Effects would be triggered as guests explored, with skeletons, loud noises and spooky music adding to the theme. The success of Doom and Sons and its themed environments paved the way for further immersive attractions over the years. When Tussauds took over the park, they saw the potential and a new headline haunted attraction was planned. The haunted house and new area, Gloomy Wood, opened at the opposite side of the park in 1992. Unfortunately, Doom and Sons could not compete with the higher capacity modern ride, and it eventually closed its doors at the end of the 1992 season. The closure was followed by the redevelopment of the area to become the land of make-believe, and eventually the opening of Toyland Tours. The funeral parlour would become part of the Teddy Town and party room scenes, with parts of the theming still being visible backstage when the ride was again transformed into Charlie and the Chocolate Factory. After the opening of the Corkscrew in 1980, Alton Towers was determined to continue to evolve and in 1981 opened a multitude of new attractions. Around the World in 80 Days was added as the headline ride in Talbot Street. This water ride was a family edition, complementing the Wild Water Flume on the other side of the park. Around the World in 80 Days was the first dark ride to be installed at Alton Towers and was built close to the Talbot restaurant behind the towers. Spectacularly themed, it was a family attraction on a scale never before seen at the park. Riders would join Phileas Fogg on his journey around the globe. While Phileas would travel by hot air balloon, park visitors would board small boats for the journey that started at the docks of London. Sailing down the Thames, visitors would soon find themselves in Siam with its temples and tigers, before travelling to Egypt to be entertained by a reanimated mummy. The boats would make their way to New York on the 4th of July, before exploring the canals of Venice. After a stop in Antarctica, visitors returned to America to witness Elvis perform in Las Vegas. Back in Europe, the sights of Vienna could be seen, as well as the windmills of Holland. A stop at the Rio Carnival was followed by the grand finale Paris scene, featuring dancers from the Moulin Rouge. The theme of the ride was again provided by Keith Sparks and Associates, who worked on nearby Doom and Sums, and was impressive for a park of its size. Each scene was carefully constructed with detailed sets and populated with an animatronic cast. In fact, while a family attraction, the level of detail was appreciated more by the older demographic, and it was not as engaging to a younger audience. This was rectified in the 1990s, and the final world tour was completed in 1993. When the park opened for the 1994 season, Around the World in 80 Days had been replaced by the fun and colourful Toyland Tours. The new attraction utilised the existing water channel, but took visitors on a journey through a larger-than-life toy factory. The ride system was again reused for Charlie and the Chocolate Factory The Ride, and the boats are now used to transport traitors through the Alton Towers dungeon. Building on the popularity of the magic carpet, which had opened the same year, 1001 Nights was installed at the park halfway through the 1984 season. The ride was unsurprisingly a 1001 Nights model, and was installed close to the Corkscrew Festival Park. There was no disguising that this was a travelling ride from a German manufacturer, and even the branding on the ride remained in the native language. Visitors would board one of eight rows on the magic carpet themed gondola. The rows faced inwards towards a large genie figure that stood proud in the centre holding his magic lamp aloft. Simple lap bar restraints would secure riders before the gondola swung backwards and forwards and eventually completing a full rotation. 1001 Knights stood 26 metres high and looked impressive when featured on print and television adverts. The image of the ride flying above the tree line was iconic and offered those brave enough to try it a view over the park and surrounding countryside. A favourite with park guests and lasting well into the 1990s, 1001 Knights' downfall was due to a number of reasons. The park had been expanding aggressively and a travelling ride didn't fit the new heavily themed direction that Alton Towers was going in. The park was also facing increasingly restrictive planning regulations, and rides above the tree line were not positively looked upon by local authorities. 1001 Knights gave its last flight at the end of the 1994 season, to be replaced by Energizer the following year. After acquiring Alton Towers in 1990, Tussauds recognised the potential of the property as a fully-fledged theme park featuring immersive and engaging themed areas. Extensive plans were made for the 1992 season, which would see a refurbishment of the Grand Canyon Rapids and the addition of a new roller coaster to create an African-inspired area, Katanga Canyon. This ride would be complemented by a second new area, Gloomy Wood, and would feature a new headline dark ride, The Haunted House. The Haunted House opened in 1992 and was an attraction on a scope and scale never before seen in the UK. The two new 1992 additions were heavily advertised to ensure the public were aware of the new direction the park was taking. Walking down a wooded path and emerging into a clearing, guests would find a mysterious, grand but dilapidated house. Their experience would begin as they followed a path through a nearby graveyard that would lead to the front steps of the house. Walking through the door, they would pass a gallery entrance and enter a dimly lit drawing room that seemed to be off balance. Journeying deeper into the house, they would board one of the six passenger ride vehicles for a 5-minute tour through the mysterious mansion. The church pew-style ride vehicles progressed through the various rooms of the house and grounds while visitors were haunted by a cast of animatronic spooks. The detailed sets and atmospheric soundtrack combined to create an immersive experience that was a smash hit with guests. The success of these 1992 attractions pushed the park to install more themed experiences in the 1990s. By the turn of the millennium, interactivity had become popular at theme parks, and the Haunted House was closed at the end of 2002 to become Jewel. For 2003, the ride cars were fitted with laser blasters, and the house glowed with thousands of LED targets. While popular with visitors, the transformation into a shooting dark ride somewhat took away from the original atmosphere of the Haunted House. By 2022, Jewel and the house were beginning to look tired, and many effects had long ceased to work. The house was once again reimagined, removing the interactive blasters. The Haunted House was updated with modern effects and a new storyline, which will continue to scare visitors for years to come. An icon of early 1990s advertising, the Swanboat ride arrived in Aqualand for the 1987 season. Located on a small lake close to the courtyard and replacing the splash cats that were moved to the main lake, the Swanboats were a slow-moving ride around the lake, offering a relaxing alternative to the more intense thrills at the theme park. While appearing to float freely, the swans were actually controlled by a series of 13 underwater pulleys. Designed by Intamin, each swan was attached to a cable below the surface that controlled the speed and direction of the boat. The swan boats became an iconic attraction at the park and were featured in many of its promotional material. The image of swans floating on the lake with the towers behind was used extensively and was even included in television adverts. Despite being an icon for Alton Towers, the swan boats could not match the thrills offered by the newer additions being installed at the resort. There was rarely a wait to board one of the swans, and they were quietly removed in 2003 after 17 years of service. Initially, the small lake was used for the pay-per-play splash cart challenge, before eventually being used for Battle Galleons, a Max Splash Battle attraction. Joining the lineup in Festival Park in 1995 was Energizer. This Mondale Supernova ride was installed on the plot vacated by 1001 Nights the previous year. While a quiet year for additions, Alton Towers was keen to provide additional thrills and absorb the crowds attracted by the installation of Nemesis the prior year. Sporting a bright red, yellow and gold colour scheme, the ride was not heavily themed, but was an improvement on the travelling ride it replaced, and pleased planning authorities as it remained below the tree line. A 44 passenger gondola was suspended between two arms that would rotate. Although similar to a topspin, the arms could move independently, allowing the gondola to tilt, twist and swing. While the model could support it, Alton Towers ran Energizer on a cycle that did not invert, allowing it to appeal to more of its park visitors. The success of themed lands like Katanga Canyon and Forbidden Valley encouraged Alton Towers to refresh more areas of the park. In 1998, Oblivion opened as the world's first vertical drop roller coaster, and the whole Fantasy World area was rethemed to X Sector, a sinister government research facility. As part of this retheme, Energizer was relocated to the bottom end of the area and was repainted a sleek black to match the style of the other attractions. Energizer continued to thrill X Sector visitors for a further 3 years before being replaced by Submission. Instead of being removed, Energizer was again relocated within the park and returned to its original spot. Festival Park, however, was no more and had been transformed into prehistoric Ugland in 1999. The ride took on a new name, Boneshaker, and received a third retheme. Boneshaker featured a new paint scheme to fit the area, with animal prints and a large bone placed on the gondola spine. Because this was a more family-friendly land, the ride was run with a less intense setting, and due to its out-of-the-way location, suffered from declining popularity. For 2004, the ride was standing but not operating, visible behind a fence. It was removed later that year, and after a period in storage, it was returned to the manufacturer. Around the same time, a refurbished Supernova opened at Terra Mítica in Spain. While not confirmed, it is likely the Anger of Achilles is in fact a refurbished Boneshaker. Joining the park's lineup in 1983 was the Mini Dragon. This junior roller coaster was located in the Talbot Centre area, close to the Corkscrew. Itself a Pinfari Wacky Worm style coaster, it offered milder thrills for Alton Towers' younger guests, as well as those not ready for the big thrill rides that had begun being installed in the still new theme park. The Mini Dragon featured oriental theming, with pagoda station styling and Chinese lanterns around the length of its red and white track structure. Riders boarded a 24-passenger green dragon-shaped train, complete with head, tail, scales and wings. The train turned immediately out of the station and began a slow climb up the small lift hill. After another slow curve, the train would enter the first drop, picking up speed and racing through a 180-degree curve, before dropping through a canvas tunnel and returning to the station for another go round the full circuit. The roller coaster stayed in place when the area's name was changed to Festival Park, and by 1987 it was known as the Dragon Roller Coaster. When the Beast was moved from Coaster Corner to Thunder Valley in 1992, the Dragon was also relocated. Joining its bigger brother, it became known as the Beastie and was offered as a family-friendly alternative to the New Beast. In 1997, the ride moved again, heading over to Adventureland with the Galloper's Carousel. When it moved, it received a new red and green colour scheme, but lost most of its oriental theming, with only the tunnel remaining. The Beastie gave its last rides to young thrill seekers in 2010, and for a number of years sat at the park behind a large fence. It was removed in 2013, and would eventually be replaced by Octonauts Roller Coaster Adventure. The Beastie found a new home at Barry Island. Operating there since 2018, the ride received a new name, Dragon Challenge, and a bright repaint. Over in Dark Forest, if you look closely, remains of the wall that once surrounded the Mini Dragon can still be seen near 13. Many attractions have come and gone at Alton Towers, evolving to offer new excitement or disappearing altogether from the map. While visitors can no longer experience these once popular additions, the memories of these lost rides still linger on, having shaped and inspired the theme park we know today.